This video is sponsored by Magellan TV.
Stars are beautiful to look at. They appear as tiny pinpoints of light and seem to be permanently fixed upon the sky. The exception, of course, is our sun, but if anything, it's a typical star. It does what stars do by fusing hydrogen into helium in its core, creating energy in the process. There's enough hydrogen fuel to keep the sun burning for about 10 to 11 billion years, but our sun is already 4.5 billion years old. What happens when that hydrogen is exhausted in 5.5 billion years? Let's find out and see how low-mass stars like our sun will evolve and eventually die. Welcome back to Launchpad. I'm Christian Reddy, your friendly neighborhood astronomer. In our previous video on how stars work, we learned that stars exist in a delicate balance between the energy radiating from its core, which exerts a pressure against the surrounding layers. Meanwhile, the surrounding layers attempt to crush the star inward, exerting pressure on the core, which sustains its nuclear fusion. But sooner or later, the star's supply of hydrogen fuel runs out. And when that happens, the star begins to die. How exactly a star dies depends on its mass. More massive stars burn through their fuel very fast and end their lives in spectacular supernova explosions, while low-mass stars evolve and die in a less explosive, yet still very dramatic way. The dividing line between high and low-mass stars is at roughly around 8 times the mass of our sun. We're going to talk about the end of high-mass stars in an upcoming video, but for now, let's focus on how low-mass stars, such as our own sun, evolve and die. We talked about the lowest-mass stars, the red dwarfs, in a previous video. Red dwarf stars burn their fuel slowly, so they last for up to trillions of years, at which point they more or less fade away to become black dwarfs. At least that's what we think will happen. The universe is only 13.8 billion years old, so even the oldest red dwarf is still in its stellar infancy. But starting at around half the sun's mass, things get a lot more interesting. Our sun is 4.5 billion years old, so it's about halfway through its normal main sequence lifetime. It spends its time burning hydrogen into helium in the core. The conditions in the sun's core are hellish. Pressures are 250 billion times greater than on Earth, and the temperature in the core is 15 million Kelvin. Yet despite those crazy numbers, the gas basically behaves more or less like a normal, albeit very hot and highly pressurized gas. The way a gas behaves is defined by the ideal gas law. This law states that increasing the pressure on the gas raises its temperature and vice versa. The more the star squeezes on the core, the higher the temperature goes and the hotter it gets. 15 million Kelvin is hot enough to get hydrogen fusing into helium, but not hot enough to fuse helium into anything heavier. So inert helium just builds up in the core like ash in a fireplace. But helium is 4 times heavier than hydrogen. As it builds up, it squeezes the core harder, causing the pressures and temperatures to rise. As helium ash builds up in the core, hydrogen fusion slowly migrates outward, eventually forming a shell of burning hydrogen surrounding an inert helium core. The sun is about halfway through this transition today. But as the temperature increases, the rate of fusion accelerates, and the star burns hotter and faster. In another 4.5 billion years, it'll be 67% brighter. Less than 2 billion years after that, it'll be more than twice as bright as it is today. By this time, Earth has long since burned to a searing rock. The oceans and atmosphere have long vaporized, and temperatures hover around 600 degrees Fahrenheit. Meanwhile, the rate of fusion in the sun's core continues to accelerate. The sun is evolving so rapidly now, it leaves the main sequence and becomes a subgiant star. Around the year 7.1 billion, the sun's core has accumulated so much extra mass, it begins to overcome the pressure exerted by the hot gas, and the core contracts. By the time the core has reached 13% of the sun's total mass, the electrons at its center are squeezed so tightly together that they run up against the Pauli exclusion principle. This principle states that no two electrons with the same spin may occupy the same energy level at the same location. Normally, this isn't a problem. Electrons have plenty of room to move around and can easily avoid each other. But now the electrons are squeezed so close together that every possible energy state is filled. The electrons have turned into a new and ultra-dense state of matter called a degenerate gas. In degenerate matter, the ideal gas law breaks down. Adding heat to a normal gas causes it to expand and cool. But a degenerate gas cannot expand, So adding heat to it just causes the temperature to climb higher. Electron degeneracy begins in the center of the core, but as more helium is added to it, it expands and grows, and eventually the entire helium core becomes degenerate. This sets up an ultra-powerful degeneracy pressure and prevents the sun from collapsing in on itself. But doing so sets the sun's evolution into overdrive. And just 500 million years after the onset of electron degeneracy, the sun is 34 times brighter than it is today. 45 million years after that, and the sun is 105 times brighter. And in just 40 million times after that, the sun is 2,300 times brighter than it is today. The sun expands and grows to Venus's present-day orbit. As the surface grows larger, it gets farther away from the core and cools down. The sun is now a red giant. It seems like a paradox. On the one hand, the sun is emitting far more energy now than it ever has in its past. But the surface is so much larger that less energy ends up passing through each square meter of its surface. There are more square meters now, so less energy is passing through each of them and the sun cools down. By the time the sun reaches its peak luminosity, it burns through more fuel in just 6 million years than it has in the 11 billion years leading up to it. This burn rate cannot last. Something's gotta give, and when it does, the sun's fate is sealed. We're going to find out what happens next in just a moment, but first, I want to take a moment to thank Magellan TV for sponsoring today's video. Magellan TV is a new type of documentary streaming service that was founded by filmmakers. They feature genres including space, science, history, and nature. I really like their documentaries on the birth of planet Earth, the birth of black holes, using black holes as starships, and the world's most powerful telescopes. New programs are added on a weekly basis and can be watched anywhere, anytime on your television, laptop, or mobile device. It's compatible with Roku, Amazon Fire TV, Apple TV, Google Play, and iOS. Documentaries are streamed without interruption, and there are no ads or limited access. There's a wide variety of programs available in 4K at no additional cost. Magellan TV is a great service, and I recommend checking them out. The first 100 visitors to magellantv.com/launchpadastronomy will get a one-month free trial. I'll have a link here and in the description below. As the sun expands as a red giant, its degenerate helium core contracts further as more helium is added to it. This sends the temperatures up to 100 million Kelvin. At that temperature, three helium nuclei will fuse into a carbon nucleus. This leads to a runaway chain reaction of helium fusion called the helium flash. In just a matter of minutes, the core emits more energy than all of the stars in the galaxy combined. But in a weird twist of quantum mechanics, the sun's core absorbs all of the energy of the helium flash. It rapidly expands and breaks free of the electron degeneracy. From the outside, the sun doesn't appear to be any different at all. But the helium flash comes at an enormous cost. Electron degeneracy is broken, so the helium core expands and cools. Less heat is pumped into the hydrogen-burning shell, so it emits less energy. This sudden loss of energy causes the sun to shrink like a deflating balloon. In just 10,000 years, the sun is less than 2% its red giant diameter. The sun is still 10 times hotter than it is today, and its surface heats up to an orange-yellow temperature. But it seems like its red giant days are over. They're not. Its helium-fusing core is surrounded by a hydrogen-burning shell. But the insanely high temperatures needed to keep the helium fusing means that it must burn through its helium core 100 times faster than it burned through its original hydrogen core. Now it's inert carbon and even some oxygen that's building up in the core. The oxygen's created when a carbon and helium atom fuse, producing some additional energy in the process. The relentless increase in density causes the helium to fuse faster and faster, adding yet more and more carbon into the core. Eventually, the carbon core becomes degenerate and temperatures skyrocket. The sun enters into a second red giant phase and ascends the asymptotic giant branch of the HR diagram. Its outer layers expand beyond Jupiter's orbit, and its luminosity climbs to more than 3,000 times the present-day sun. Despite these temperatures, the core cannot get hot enough to fuse carbon. The helium shell expands, but in doing so, it overtakes the slower burning hydrogen shell. The helium shell cuts off its own supply of helium fuel, and the helium shell just sputters out. The sun contracts, compressing the helium shell back into electron degeneracy. This sets off a mini helium flash in the shell, which in turn dumps more carbon, which in turn drives the temperatures ever hotter, and the sun re-expands once again. The helium shell overtakes the hydrogen shell once again, and the sun contracts a second time. This cycle repeats itself every 100,000 years. Each time it expands, the core's gravitational grip on the surface gets weaker and weaker. Eventually, chunks of the surface break off and are blown away in a fast stellar wind. After four or five of these convulsions, the sun coughs out its final breath. Its outer layers have expanded beyond the solar system. Its exposed core is a 170,000 Kelvin ball of degenerate carbon and helium. It weighs 55% of the sun's original mass, yet is compressed to a volume no larger than Earth. The sun is now a white dwarf. It's so hot, it radiates mostly at X-rays and ultraviolet wavelengths. Stars that are slightly more massive than the sun can produce white dwarfs that are so hot that they actually can ionize and illuminate their surrounding expanding shells, causing them to glow. These objects are called planetary nebula, and we're going to be talking more about them in an upcoming video. It's not yet clear if a planetary nebula will be the sun's ultimate swan song. It's arguably on the lower end of stars that are capable of producing planetary nebulae. But what is inarguable is that the sun is now well and truly dead. With no more pressure bearing down on the core, it will never reignite into helium fusion. It will spend the next 100 billion years or so gradually cooling off, eventually to become a black dwarf. So what about the Earth? Well, obviously it doesn't fare very well through any of this, but its ultimate fate is really not yet clear. The sun will ultimately expand to beyond Earth's orbit, but that doesn't necessarily mean that Earth will be swallowed up by the red giant sun. During its red giant phases, the sun will shed as much as 45% of its mass through its stellar wind. As it loses mass, its gravitational hold on Earth weakens, and Earth spirals away from the sun. It's possible that by the time the sun's outer layers reaches Earth's present-day orbit, Earth will have migrated to well beyond Mars's orbit. However, it's also possible that Earth will drag against the thick wind of material blasting out from the sun. In that case, Earth would just spiral into the red giant. Regardless of its fate, Earth will be little more than an exposed core of nickel and iron. Its surface and mantle would have been vaporized long ago by the expanding red giant sun. So, what then of us? Or rather, what then of our evolutionary descendants? Well, they will have to leave Earth behind and migrate out to the outer solar system long before the sun has even entered into the red giant phase. Fortunately, the sun will give them a hand. As it evolves, its habitable zone will expand into the outer solar system. Perhaps humanity will make its final stand from the tropical zones of the moons of Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, and Neptune. They'll spend the next few million years basking in the red glow of the dying sun. After its outer shells expand past them, all that will be left of the sun is its white dwarf core. Our descendants will have to migrate elsewhere into the galaxy, where hopefully they could set up shop for the next few billion years or so. It seems like a bleak ending for the sun, but in fact, it's an essential part of the cycle of stellar life. The sun effectively returns to the interstellar medium from which it came, this time enriching the medium with helium, carbon, oxygen, nitrogen, and other elements. Those elements will then go on to build the next generation of stars, planets, and possibly even life. I'd like to take a second and thank my Patreon supporters for helping to make this video and indeed this entire channel possible. If you'd like to help Launchpad Astronomy keep flying, please make sure to visit my Patreon page. I'll have a link in the description. And if you'd like to learn how the most massive stars evolve and die, well, please make sure to subscribe and ring that notification bell so that you don't miss out when the next video arrives. Until then, stay curious, my friends.